Hi guys, Dr. J here, and in this video we're going to talk about ground control points, and specifically ground control points for doing photogrammetry with UAVs or drones. Ground control points are going to give us a way to tie points in our image with known locations. And you've got an example here of a ground control point. This is like a flag, and this is actually me measuring the GPS location of a benchmark. So this would be our base station. We'll talk more about base stations in a separate video. But by you setting up a base station and then having a location where we have a flag on the ground, and we can measure the location of this flag with GPS, the very center of the flag, with very high precision, we now know exactly where that flag is, and we can identify that point in our photographs when we're doing a photogrammetric mission. And we're going to use that information to help improve our, well, one is to help improve our photogrammetry process. And then two is actually to check our results, our photogrammetric results, and see how accurate they are in terms of three-dimensional locations. Accurate GCPs are needed to reference the photogrammetric ground control points, or GCPs, are needed. In some cases, they're required for when doing photogrammetry, because if your photos are not already georeferenced, then you have to have ground control points so that you're able to tell where your photos were taken. If you have no georeferencing on your photos and you don't have ground control, then you can still do photogrammetry. You can still take your photos, and the software will, or the algorithm will, identify points in each photo and tie them all together, but you won't have any idea of the scale of that image. And usually your actual orthomosaic won't be quite as accurate. And for example, your 3D point cloud might have some curvature in it, for example. GCPs are, as this quote from Pix4D says, points with known coordinates that can easily be identified in images. When you mark GCPs on images, you link the images with those points, and that helps you georeference the project. So for example, if you have no geotagging in your photos at all, you can still actually tie all of your photos to actual locations, latitude, longitude, positions, and elevation, by using these GCPs. So here is an image that we may have seen before. Here is a point on the ground where there's a GCP, and maybe we have several GCPs. So one thing is, if we know the camera locations and we know these angles, we've talked about this in another video, we can identify these pixels on the ground, what location they're in. If we have the pixels on the ground, we know those locations, and that's what GCPs give us, then we can work out exactly where the cameras are. And this is the way that photogrammetry works, by having different points in different images in some cases, which all correspond to each other. We can work out where the cameras are relative to each other. And then if we know what some of those pixels are, and that's our GCPs, then we can work out the absolute location of each one of our cameras, or each one of the photographs that have been taken. And this basically allows us to, again, tie our orthomosaics or 3D point clouds, not just to be relatively accurate, but to be accurate in an absolute sense. So let's talk about choosing locations for GCPs, ground control points. Now, in another video, we'll talk about how to actually do the GPS measuring. But in this video, let's assume that we know how to measure those GCPs, get their GPS locations very accurately. Let's talk about where we need to place them. So one of the things is, of course, we need to be able to see our GCPs in photographs. So if we can't see the GCP, it's like it's not there. That's not very useful. So we can actually do a few different things. We can have a flag like we saw in the other photograph, but we can also use a very easily recognizable feature. So for example, a pump on a concrete pad, a corner of a building. Those things can actually be, as long as they're unmovable and stable and unvegetated, those things can be used as ground control points. You don't actually have to use a flag for your ground control points, as long as you can identify precisely the location where you're going to measure with the GPS. And in fact, you can even use ground control points that can be surveyed later on. Let's say you did your processing and you were hoping to get higher accuracy and you need some more GCPs to help get your total accuracy up, then you can actually go back, and if you can identify things in your imagery which are easily identifiable, you can identify the exact point where you can take a GPS measurement, you can survey those in even after you've flown your photogrammetry mission. So for example, in this image, there might be several things. For example, here at this, I think this is a playground. You could identify several points here in this playground where you might be able to survey that exact point, maybe the edge of the fence, something like this. You could survey that exact point with the GPS and then use that in your photogrammetric process to do a better job creating your orthomosaics. Now for the flags or panels, if you're going to use those, you'll want them to be high contrast so that they're identifiable. Believe me, it is hard to see these GCPs on the ground from 200 feet up in the air. Usually they're fairly small, so you want to have something which is high contrast. White on black, gray on black, something like this needs to be very visible. You also want to have them oriented, so one corner, for example, should be slightly different, and ideally would be numbered so that you can tell exactly which one is which in the photographs again. So again, you might not think about this as being a big deal with 50 photographs or 10 photographs, but let's say you have 500 photographs and you're trying to quickly go through and mark your GCPs in all those photographs. Well, you need to make sure that you know exactly which GCP is in each photograph. And especially if your landscape looks similar over a large area, you could easily end up misidentifying your GCPs, and that's definitely not what you want. And I'll just say you can get GCPs like this from Amazon or different places online have them sell these flags. And they'll usually have like a number in one of these corners or maybe a special marking in a corner. I've even seen some that have like QR code type things in one corner. So you can tell the orientation, you can tell which flag it is. Now, in terms of the locations at your site, they should be located around the edges, but not at the edges. So you see here, we've got a nice distribution on this side. This is a good example. On the other side here, you've got kind of some clustering. Maybe your GCPs are a little bit too close to the edge. They're still probably a little bit too close to the edge in this one for what I would normally do, maybe a little bit away from the edge there. And that will allow you to sort of get the best. Well, one thing it will allow you to get is GCPs to show up in as many photographs as possible. So if you're right at the edge, then you're not going to have as many photographs that have those GCPs. But you want to be close to the edges so that you can constrain each one of your corners, let's say. In this case, you've got four corners. Or if you have a circular area around the edges, you want to be able to constrain the far edges of your area. And that's going to help. How is that going to help? Because as I mentioned, you can get some distortion when you do your photogrammetric process. You can get some distortion in your 3D point cloud, and those GCPs are going to help tie those down and make sure that you don't have any area, any region of your area of interest that's going to be distorted. So you want to be near the edges, but not too close, ideally. You want to have them kind of distributed around the outside, as well as a few in the middle. In terms of the number of GCPs, it's going to depend a bit on the area and what it's like. So you can see here in this case, this has got a lot of topography, a lot of elevation change in this area. And so they've actually got quite a few GCPs. If this area were flat, you could probably get away with 4 or 5, maybe 6 at the most GCPs, and you'd be just fine. When you're choosing your GCP locations, you want to be able to see the sky because you're going to use GPS most likely to tell where they are. The other way would be to do like a total station survey. So you may not need clear sky view in that case, but if you're using GPS to get positions, you're going to want to be able to see the sky as much as possible. So try to avoid trees, try to avoid tall buildings, try to avoid things that are going to block your view of satellites orbiting above you. Okay, so we've talked about GCPs. In the next video, we'll talk about using GPS to survey GCPs in and how that works.